singing God Bless America. So she's back there and wants to know. Just be aware of that so you can indicate.
All right, great job. Thank you, Don. Thank you, Johnny. Good job. You guys can sit down. You can sit down. Good morning. That young boy was my grandson, Johnny the Third. Well, it's a beautiful day the Lord's made. Rejoice. Be happy. Be happy today. And welcome to the 12th annual prayer breakfast. People are still coming in. You know, this beautiful building here that we turned into a tent was a lot of hard work. And so we would like to start by thanking our volunteers. If you could hold your applause to the end. They were here all day yesterday and the day before. I'll just list them here. Masters Academy, Teen Challenge, The Sowers, Epic Mission, Women's Refuge, King's Baptist Youth, and there's 70 individuals that make up about 300 volunteers that are going to serve you breakfast in a few minutes. Thank you, volunteers, very much. You know, we always like to start by recognizing our pastors in the community. And I know there's several here. So if you're a pastor of a church, we'd like to appreciate you. So please stand up if you're a pastor of a church. By the way, pastors, after the prayer breakfast, if you'd like to meet with Tony Perkins and his staff, they'll be in the next building. You're all invited. Pastors only. Well, by being here this morning, you've demonstrated that you care about the Christian faith and, frankly, the direction of our nation. And so we take time this morning to exalt Christ in this public square. And there's good news for you this morning. You are significant in the kingdom of God. Don't ever confuse prominence in this world with significance in the kingdom of God. For the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to Him. And so don't quit. Keep that ministry going. Whatever you're doing, have faith in God. He'll see it through. And be confident of this, that He who began a good work in you will bring it to completion in the day of Jesus Christ. So let's start this morning. We're going to read the Word of God. Let's all stand together. Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Okay, now John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. God bless you, Sheriff.
Good morning. Please remain standing for the posting of the colors of the United States of America. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Indian River County Sheriff's Office, I say thank you for the invitation, for allowing us to be honored today. I say thank you for your continued prayers throughout all of the first responders, not only in the state of Florida, in the United States of America. Last year, we lost 133 first responders in tragic incidents and accidents in the United States. So far this year, it's been a horrible year. We've lost 16, with 12 being to gunfire. And I thank you and I appreciate your prayers. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Twila, thank you for coming all the way from Arkansas to be with us. And Twila Paris will now bless us with her music as she enters us into God's presence. And let's worship him together in spirit and truth. Please welcome Twila Paris.
Good morning. Waiting for a little music to begin here, and it's a privilege to be here with you. There's no higher purpose that we could be using our morning for, is there? Any of our moments of our days. It dawned on me later than it should have that this song is not just a patriotic song, it's actually a prayer.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. The wilderness.
will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then when I'll hear from heaven, forgive their sin and heal their land.
Good morning, body of Christ. Let us pray. Precious and eternal Father, it is such a privilege to be called your children by the blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus says that when we pray, we are to pray our Father, which art in heaven. And sir, it is from that vein that we come in Jesus' name. And we just thank you for your body. We thank you for your leadership. We thank you, God, for all that you are doing in this county. We realize, God, that our nation and the world, God, is facing so many different challenges. We realize, God, that we're in an election season and we need your intervention. We realize, God, that every situation facing this nation can be dire, can be traumatic. But God, we also realize that you are our Father. And everything that we face, we're able to place it at the feet of Jesus. So God, that's what we do right now. We place the need of our communities, the needs, O God, of our nation, the needs, O God, of our world, at the feet of Jesus Christ. And we're asking you, God, because your word says that where sin abound, grace much more abounds. We're asking you, Father, to show us your glory once again. We're asking you, Father, to show us your mercy once again. We're asking you, God, to show us your favor, your forgiveness once again. For Lord, we can do nothing without you. We're helpless and hopeless without you. But Daddy, your word says with you, all things are possible to them who believe. So God, we're believing that though the word says in the last days perilous times shall come, we're also believing that your word says in the last day you'll pour out your spirit upon all flesh. So Daddy, we're praying in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us be a part, God, of that hour where you're pouring out your spirit upon all flesh. Let us be a part, God, of the revival. Let us be a part, God, of the renewal. Lord, let us be a part of you ministering to your people from sea to shiny sea. Lord, we're not giving up on America. We're not giving up on our world, because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And God, as you have summoned your body in this local community, you've summoned your body to stand in the gap, your body to lift up your name, your body, oh God, to say to a dying world that the answer is Jesus. I'm praying, oh God, that you'll anoint each of us. I'm praying, oh God, that you will equip each of us to be the light that you've caused us to be. For your word says we are indeed the light of the world and the salt of the earth. And Daddy, because of your faithfulness, because of your power and your strength, we say America is in your hands. We say our world is in your hands. So Daddy, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, show us your glory once again. We give you all the glory for it and all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Okay, enjoy breakfast. Here it comes. We'll see you in a little bit. Welcome, Twila Paris.
There we go. I'm putting that down so I can see a few more of you. Boy, that was a delicious breakfast, wasn't it? I don't usually eat a big breakfast right before I sing a concert at 8:20 in the morning, so we'll see how this goes.
But even winners can get wounded.
You know, my dad, who was also my pastor and mentor, used to say, once in a while when we would start to feel just a little bit discouraged with what was going on around us, he would say, you know, 2 Chronicles 7:14 has responsibilities for us, and all the things that are mentioned in that verse are not our responsibilities. We're responsible to humble ourselves, to bow down before God, pray, repent of our sin. But God has kept for himself the responsibility of healing our land. So my dad would say to me, look, if you're praying, if you're being responsible to do what God has called you to do, you're being obedient, then you don't have a responsibility to worry. So if anyone here this morning has taken on that little mantle of worry, that burden of worrying about our nation, just release that this morning, because God will be faithful. If we do what we're called to do, he is faithful to keep his promise. Amen. You are Lord of creation and Lord of my life, Lord of the land and the sea. You were Lord of the heavens before
is the body of that choose to forgive and never despise. How beautiful, how beautiful, how beautiful is the body.
Thank you, Twila. That was beautiful. Well, are you ready for the heavy artillery? Okay. You know, I could spend all morning up here introducing Family Research Council. The resumes of these gentlemen are off the charts. So I'll be brief. As a pastor for 25 years, Dr. Cureton has served church ministries throughout America for Family Research Council. Under his leadership, the pastor's network has grown from 1,800 pastors to over 25,000. Need I say more? Please welcome Dr. Cureton.
Thank you, John. Good to be with you. I bring greetings from Family Research Council, which is a D.C.-based ministry that was founded by Dr. James Dobson of Focus on the Family fame. to defend and advance faith, family, and freedom. And our current president is Tony Perkins. He's here. You're going to hear from him, and he is leading FRC to new heights of impact and influence. And just a little bit about FRC. FRC's vision is an American culture where human life is valued, families flourish, and religious liberty thrives. That's what we're about. So just think of FRC as your missionaries in D.C., because that's what we really are. Well, certainly, we're in the midst of an election season, right? And the scriptures have very specific guidelines for the kind of leaders that we need to represent us, right? Capable people who fear God, who are trustworthy, and who hate dishonest gain. And certainly in America, we have a great privilege of voting, right? When we vote, we help select the people who are going to make our laws and represent us and defend our freedom. So it's critical that we get it right. And of course, John Jay, founding father, first Supreme Court Justice, Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, chosen by George Washington, said that Christians have a great privilege in America, and that is to select believers to lead us. And of course, the consequences are enormous, aren't they? The scripture tells us that when the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. And when the wicked rule, the people groan. And there's a lot of groaning going on in America today. Amen. Well, when I think about the gold standard for leadership, George Washington immediately comes to mind. He was a righteous man of prayer who called out to God on behalf of the American cause. But he was also a man who was unashamed of Jesus Christ. When he was approached by the Delaware Indian tribal leaders, they were wanting their sons educated in American ways. Here's what he had to say to them. He said, "You would do well to wish to learn our arts and ways of life, and above all, the religion of Jesus Christ. These will make you a greater and a happier people than you are. Congress will do everything they can to assist you in this wise intention." Can you imagine the Congress doing that today? Well, at the end of his 8 years, only getting to go home to Mount Vernon one time during that eight-year period, he wrote a letter to the governors of the 13 states as his parting shot. He thought he was going home to Mount Vernon to retire. And here's what he had to say. He said, "I now make it my prayer that God would have you in his holy protection, and that he would be most graciously pleased to dispose us all to follow Micah 6:8, to do justice, to love mercy, and to conduct ourselves with that charity, humility, and pacific temper of mind, which were the characteristics of the divine author of our blessed religion." Who is that, folks? From Hebrews 12. Who's the author and the finisher of our faith? It's Jesus, right? And without a humble imitation of his example in these things, we can never hope to be a happy nation. Washington said, if we want to be a happy nation, we need to follow Micah 6:8 and the example of Jesus Christ. Let's say that together. If we want to be a happy nation, we need to obey Micah 6:8 and follow the example of Jesus Christ. That'll work in America again today if we'll try it. God grant us leaders like George Washington. Amen?
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you very much. You know, it was about 25 years ago. You know what it's like when you go standby on a flight? I actually got the last seat, and it was in the middle, flying from Baltimore to Florida. and I met my dear friend, the Reverend Pierre Bynum. And I could actually say in over that 25 years, he's one of the most godly men I've ever met. Please welcome Pierre Bynum.
Last night, I was talking to Dr. Keenan Cureton, who just shared, and the Lord confirmed to me what he had spoken to me about praying this morning. And I want to read something that George Washington said after his long career. And General Washington then, of course, became President Washington, and he was the greatest president, I believe, that we've ever had. And he led as a Christian. In fact, listen to this. We're at a prayer breakfast. He prayed for 2 hours a day, every day, throughout the wars, throughout his presidency. He rose early enough every morning before the day began to pray for an hour, and then before he went to sleep, he prayed for an hour every night. Thank God for a president like that. But in his farewell address, I want to read you the last two paragraphs. We're all familiar with one of those paragraphs. I'm going to read that first, and then I'm going to go to the one that was directly before it, because we're in an election year, and we can't have a prayer breakfast like this without saying something about the election. Finally, he says, of all the disposition and habits which lead to political prosperity, and let me ask you to listen real carefully here, because we're in a big room. Religion and morality are indispensable supports. In vain would that man claim the tribute of patriotism who should labor to subvert these great pillars of human happiness. These firmest props of the duties of men and citizens, the mere politician, equally with the pious man, ought to respect and cherish them. A volume could not trace all their connections with private and public felicity or happiness. Let it simply be asked, where is the security for property, for reputation, for life, if the sense of religious obligation desert the oaths which are instruments of investigation in the courts of justice? And let us with caution indulge the supposition that morality can be maintained without religion. Whatever may be conceded to the influence of refined education on the minds of peculiar structure, reason and experience both forbid us to expect that national morality can prevail in the exclusion of religious principle. It is substantially true that virtue or morality is a necessary spring of popular government. The rule, indeed, extends with more or less force to every species of free government. Who that is a sincere friend to it can look with indifference upon attempts to shake the foundations of that fabric? I don't know whether you've noticed or not, but that fabric is being shaken in America today. And the only hope for America is for God's people to arise and to do their job. And number one, to cry out to God, and to cry out to God, to pray like they've never prayed before, and then secondly, to do their duty as citizens, that great responsibility to influence our government to do right. I'm going to read you one more thing here from George Washington. This was the next to the last paragraph, and his farewell address was rather lengthy, and it was profound. Every paragraph is profound. But he said this, and again, this is talking about elections. It's important, likewise, that the habits of thinking in a free country should inspire caution and those entrusted with its administration, to confine themselves within their respective constitutional spheres, avoiding in the exercise of powers of one department to encroach upon the other. The spirit of encroachment tends to consolidate the powers of all the departments into one, and thus to create, whatever the form of government, a real despotism. A just estimate of that love of power and proneness to abuse it, which predominates in the human heart, is sufficient to satisfy us of the truth of this position. The necessity of reciprocal checks
in the exercise of political power by dividing and distributing it to different depositories and constituting each the guardian of the public weal against invasions by others has been evinced by experiments ancient and modern, some of them in our country and under our own eyes. To preserve them must be as necessary as to institute them. And our founders instituted a great and great system with the checks and balances. If in the opinion of the people, the distribution or the modification of the constitutional powers be in any particular wrong, let it be corrected by an amendment in the way which the Constitution designates. But let there be no change by usurpation. For though through this is one instance, may be the instrument of good, in one instance may be the instrument of good, it is the customary weapon by which free governments are destroyed. The president must always greatly overbalance in permanent evil any partial or transitional benefit which the use can at any time yield. We are in great danger in America of doing exactly what that happened. Just for y'all to know, if you don't remember this from history, George Washington, they wanted to make him a king. There are a lot of people in our nation who, despite what we'd gone through, wanted to make George Washington a king. And then, of course, he was encouraged to run for a third term. But his farewell address was to say to the people, I'm not going to run for a third term. And because our government was set, so we have temporary presidents. Let's pray. Father, you said in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 and following, Lord, that first of all we should pray for all men, and in specific kings and all those who are in authority. Lord, that we might lead. Lord, let me just read it specifically here. That we might lead peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. So, Lord, we pray that today. Lord, we pray for our leaders. Lord, we pray for our president. Lord, we pray for, Lord, the members of Congress. Lord, we pray for our Supreme Court. Lord, we pray for our governors, Lord, and our legislators in all the states, all 50 states, Lord, and in our not states, but our possessions, our territories. Lord, we pray that you will raise up, especially in this next election that's right on us, Lord, that you'll raise up God-fearing men. Lord, those who meet your requirements, Lord, to serve in civil authority. Lord, Moses was told that, number one, they must have the ability to do the job, a track record with the ability. Number two, Lord, that they would fear God. Number three, that they would love the truth. And number four, that they would hate covetousness or dishonest gain. God, help your church, Lord, to have eyes to see. Help your people to have discernment, Lord, that they might do according to your will and according to your bidding, and to raise up such men in this, Lord, critical hour. Father, we pray for leaders everywhere, not just those in political authority, but, Lord, those that are in the authority of the seven mountains or the seven spheres, Lord, of our nation, Lord. Those that are in business, Lord, business leaders. Lord, we pray for those that are in educational leadership in our great, Lord, organizations for learning, Lord, our public schools as well as our higher education. Lord, we pray for those that are in the entertainment, Lord, and the arts world, Lord, who so influence this nation. Lord, we pray for the family, and Lord, especially for fathers. God, raise up fathers who will lead, Lord, according to the word of God. Lord, and nurture children, Lord God, who will follow hard after you and will know what to do in a critical time like this. Father, we pray Lord, most of all today, I want to pray for the pastors of America. Lord, who are our leaders. Lord, who lead us in the spiritual things. Lord, if we're going to be salt and light in our nation, Lord, we need great pastors. Lord, we need bold pastors. Lord, we need courageous pastors who will speak the truth. Lord, whether it upsets the church or, Lord, whether it upsets the community, Lord, without the truth, we will never be set free. Oh, Lord, Spirit of the living God, we pray, fall fresh on us today. Lord, as Tony ministers the word, Lord, we pray that you will revive us. Lord, today, before I finish, Lord, forgive us of our sins. Lord, we confess that we've sinned grievously. Lord, we acknowledge that we have not been salt and light like we ought to have been. Otherwise, our nation would not be in the condition that it's in. But Lord, we pray that you'll grant us repentance, Lord, that we will repent of sin of every kind. Lord, we pray that you'll lead us into great solemn assemblies, Lord, even this year. Lord God, that you might find a repentant people that you can have mercy upon, Lord. And Lord, to give us leaders, not what we deserve, but Lord, what we so desperately need that will represent righteousness. Lord, as was said earlier, Lord, when the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked bear rule, the King James Version says, the people mourn. God, please do not give us cause for mourning. But Lord, let us rejoice, Lord, this year. Lord, let us lead our people back to you, the living God, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. We worship you today, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Well, in God's created order, the family is the primary unit in human society, as Pierre said. God intended the family to exercise dominion over the earth in two fundamental respects, namely children and property. The authority over both of these is uniquely and originally vested in the family, the God-ordained family. And as Pierre said and prayed, it's impossible to reclaim America apart from this family, this institution. And that's what Tony Perkins and the Family Research Council is all about. He's been the president for many years, and he's established himself as an innovative pro-life and pro-family leader since first being elected to office in 1996. He authored and passed the nation's first covenant marriage law in 1997, a year later. He didn't waste any time. And during his tenure as FRC's president, Tony has deepened the organization's influence on Capitol Hill and across the United States. He's also expanded the organization's reach across the nation by building major networks of pastors and churches, encouraging them to impact the culture, thinking nationally but acting locally. Tony is an ordained minister, and he remains active in many Christian ministries. He's a host of a nationally syndicated radio show, and he's a veteran of the United States Marines. Please welcome the President of Research Council, Tony Perkins.
Thank you, Tony, for coming. Very appreciate it. Thank you, John. Thank you very much. It's great to be here in California. In fact, it's not California, is it? Your politics are a little better than that, aren't they? Actually, it's great to be outside of Washington, D.C. And I will avoid what Ronald Reagan, the governor of California, once said. He said, the 8 most frightening words in the English language are, I'm from Washington and I'm here to help. I want to thank John for his vision in having this prayer breakfast in this community and calling the community together. Let me tell you what, this is one of the things that encourages me. And Sheriff, I thank you for being here. Twila, it's great to see you again. I appreciate your years of ministry. And Pastor Pierce, thank you for your leadership in this community. And I have to tell you, I'm encouraged by this. When I see communities coming together under the banner of Jesus Christ and praying for their communities, it gives me hope for America. So thank you for being here this morning and being a part of this vision of reaching this community and declaring that Jesus is in fact Lord. Now, I'll give you a little disclaimer here. I'm much more comfortable here at this prayer breakfast than I am in Washington, D.C. with a lot of politicians. And the reason is because when I was 15 years old, long before I ever thought of politics, the Lord called me to preach. I began preaching at 15 in nursing homes. Now, little did I know that that was preparation for the legislature. I have found that both groups are a little hard of hearing and slow of moving. Now, I can't speak without telling at least one political joke. You may have heard this one. It was these three guys, similar to Pierre and John. They were on a plane together, and they got talking, and they were making a connecting flight, and the connecting flight was canceled. And they were there at the counter talking. They found out they were all headed to the same city. All three needed to be there the next morning. And so they said, well, hey, how about we just get a rental car and we'll drive? They said, oh, that's good. That sounds like an idea. So they got together, got a rental car, and they began driving. And they got off into the country and got lost. And then the car broke down. And it was in front of this farmhouse. And so they decided, well, let's go up and see if maybe they'll let us spend the night. So they went to the door and they knocked on the door. Now this was a kind of an eclectic group of three. One was an Orthodox rabbi. One was a Hindu, and one was a politician. So they knock on the door. The farmer answers the door, and they say, hey, look, our car is broken down. It's late. We need a place to stay. And the farmer said, well, not a problem. Look, you guys come on in. I've got 2 bedrooms upstairs, and we've got a loft in the barn. 2 of you can stay upstairs and 1 outside. Well, the Hindu being the rabbi, he was such a gentleman. He said, look, you 2 go upstairs, take the bedroom. I'll go out in the barn. So the farmer walked the rabbi out to the barn and showed him to the loft and went back in the house, locked the door, got in bed, and it wasn't 5 minutes, there was a knock at the door. So he goes to the door and opens it, and there's the rabbi, and he says, I'm sorry, there's a pig in the barn, I can't stay there. So the Hindu said, not a problem, I'll go to the barn, he can have my bed. So the farmer takes the Hindu out to the barn, shows him to the loft, and goes back in the house, locks the door, shuts. Goes to bed, and it wasn't 5 minutes later, knock at the door. Goes to the door, opens, there's the Hindu, says, I'm sorry, there's a cow in the barn, I can't stay there. So the politician reluctantly says, all right, I'll stay in the barn, you know, he can have the bedroom upstairs. So the farmer takes the politician out to the barn, shows him the loft, he gets in there and gets all settled, and so the farmer goes back into the house, locks the door, gets in bed. Wasn't 5 minutes later, there's a knock at the door. He opens the door, it was the cow and the pig. Now, I can share those kind of stories because I'm a recovering politician, okay? I'm on the 12-step program of recovery. Now, my wife and I this month will actually celebrate 30 years of marriage. It is my wife that deserves all the applause. But when we were first married, our first year of marriage was my last year in the Marine Corps. Now, how many veterans, all of our military veterans, stand up. Let's thank our veterans for their service. all of our veterans. Thank you for your service. Thank you. Thank you for your service to our country, and those of you who have family members continuing to serve, we thank you for your sacrifice as well. Now, I will say I made a mistake. I thought everything I learned from the Marine Corps I could apply to my marriage. Now, I couldn't not figure out, 6 months into our marriage, all communication broke down. I could not figure out what was wrong with that woman. Now, I'll be very candid. We never spoke of divorce. That never came up in our conversation. Murder came up a couple times, but never divorce. Until one day, she pointed to the duty roster that I had posted for her on the refrigerator. It was at that point I had a revelation that not everything that worked for my first sergeant would work for me. But we have had 25 years of wonderful marriage. Took us a few years, and we now have 5 children. We're blessed. In fact, it was on our 21st wedding anniversary, I got a kind of a shock. My wife called me. I was in the office in Washington, and we continue. Our home is in Louisiana. I commute back and forth. And she said, "I hope you're sitting down." I said, "Why?" She said, "Well, we're going to have a baby." I thought, wow. I didn't realize that's what you get your spouse on the 21st anniversary. And I will say that the first words out of my mouth were not the most profound words I've ever uttered. I said, "How did that happen?" I have figured that out, yeah. But after the initial impression and shock, it was exciting because we'd actually been praying. We were thinking about adopting. I said, "You know, you just need to be more specific in your prayers when you're praying for a baby." And so about 3 months into this, we decided we needed to tell all the other children. At the time, we had 4. We had 3 girls and 1 boy. We got them into the study, and we said, "Look, we just want to let you know that we're soon going to have someone else living in the house." Well, they began to guess which grandparent was moving in. I said, no, Mama's going to have a baby. Well, the girls were elated. They were talking about how they were going to dress up the baby, carry them around, have all kinds of fun. And my son, who was about 8 years old at the time, did not say a word the entire time. He was stoic. He sat there and just looked at me. And when all of the celebration was over, he said, "Dad, if it's another girl, I'm out of here." And for 6 months, David kept his suitcase by his bedroom door, packed and ready to go. Now, I'm happy to say that with the birth of Samuel Adam Perkins, that David decided to stay. By the way, some of my non-Baptist friend asked me, "Did you name Samuel Adam after the beer?" I said, "No." No, but we do call him Bud for short. You know, there is great fear in the unknown. And if I were to describe something happening in America today, and the single greatest factor that I think is hanging over the head of families, is looming in the distance for our nation, it is fear of the unknown. And we've talked a little bit about the election, and I'm often asked by reporters at least 3 or 4 times a day in the last couple of weeks, what is it about evangelicals that they're split in how they're voting, and they're voting over here, and they're voting over here, and they're actually attracted to candidates who are not evangelical? How do you explain that? And I think it's rather relatively complex, but there are two factors that I can readily identify. One is frustration with the political system that overpromises and underperforms. But then there is the issue of fear. There is a fear of the unknown, a fear of what is happening to our nation, a fear of what may happen to the economy, a fear of this, a fear of that. And folks, I'm just going to tell you, that is not God's design for his children to live in fear. And as Pastor Pierce mentioned earlier, being a child of God does not come by birth, not by the first birth. It comes by the second birth. We are children of God when we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and our Savior. And God has a design and a purpose for each one of you this morning. And I can tell you with great assurance, clarity, and conviction that his plan is not for you to live in fear. In Matthew chapter 10, Jesus says, "And do not fear those who can kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell." There is too much fear among God's people today. And if you leave with nothing else this morning than this, know that God's plan for you is to dwell in peace and the security that comes from knowing him. You see, fear paralyzes while faith propels. You can't do both. You can't live as a person of faith and a person gripped by fear, because fear says retreat, faith says advance. God wants you to be a person of faith. God's plan for you and for me is not for us to be victims, but victors. Not to be wallflowers, but to be wall builders. God's plan is not for us to hunker down in fear. Rather, it is to stand up in faith. And we see that faith today under great attack, which has caused many Christians to retreat within the four walls of their church. And I'm here this morning to say it is not time to shut the doors and bar the walls and the windows, but rather it is time to take the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the hope that it brings outside the walls of our churches and into our communities. Let me tell you about a young lady from Texas, Angela Hildebrand, who I wrote about in the book that I recently released called No Fear. In 2011, a federal judge, Judge Fred Berry, threatened Angela, a 17-year-old who was the Medina Valley High School valedictorian, with jail if she prayed or even mentioned God in her valedictorian address. In fact, the judge went so far as to say an order for marshals, U.S. marshals, to be at that graduation, to wait for the word prayer to be mentioned and then make the arrest. In his official order, Judge Berry wrote this, and I quote from the court document, "These students and all other persons scheduled to speak during the graduation ceremony shall be instructed not to present a prayer, to wit, they shall be instructed that they may not ask audience members to stand, join in prayer, or bow their heads. They may not end their remarks with amen or in a deity's name we pray. And they shall not otherwise deliver a message that would commonly be understood to be a prayer, nor may they use the word prayer," end quote. When I was interviewing Angela for the book about this encounter with the federal judge and the very real threat of going to jail in San Antonio and being placed in a jail cell with gang members and others, I asked her, at what moment, Angela, did you decide that you were going to defy the federal judge and you were going to pray and give God the glory for what he had done in your life? And she said this. She said, "Well, I had prayed about it." And she said, "When I prayed about it, then I spoke to my father. And when I talked to my father," her earthly father, she said, "I knew at that moment that I had to stand, even though jail was very real." Now, her story because of her bold stand. At the last moment, the judge's order was overturned, and she was able to pray, and she was able to give God the glory. But what if that 17-year-old girl would not have been willing to stand? You see, I'm encouraged because what I see happening across this nation, there are young people. We're told that this generation is lost. In fact, there is more of a commitment to the truth of Jesus Christ among young people today than I ever saw in my generation, because there is a cost, and they have counted the cost, and they're willing to pay it. Let me very quickly, I want to read this passage of Scripture in Matthew chapter 10. I'll give you the context here. Jesus had called his disciples sometime before. They were disciples in training, and he was sending them out on a little test run. He was going to send them out two by two to go out and preach the gospel, and this was just preparation. It was a part of the on-the-job training that disciples go through. And he warned them in advance that there were going to be those who reject you, who ridicule you, who mock you, and there are even some that want to kill you. But be happy about it. I mean, have you ever been to a job interview where they call you, you go in and they say, here's the deal. Everyone's going to reject you, they're going to hate you, you're not going to get a paycheck, and it's going to be horrible. Hey, where do I sign? So he tells them that, and we begin in verse 16. He says, behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Now, that's sure encouraging. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise up against their parents and have them put to death, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I say to you, you will not have gone through the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both body and soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father, but even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge him before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny him before my Father who is in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against his mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a person's enemies will be those of his own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives me receives, whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me. If we are to truly follow Jesus Christ in the times in which we live today, we must face the reality that challenges await us. Challenges that can create fear, real fear. But if we are to obey and honor God, our faith must overrule our fears. And that is done by living with a greater reverence for God than for a fear of man. Very quickly, we see that Jesus lays out here that we're going to face rejection and resentment. In verse 14, He says, if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake the dust from your feet and leave that house or town. You see, Jesus is preparing them ahead of time. There are going to be those that are going to reject you. Look, we should not be surprised when the world does not roll out the red carpet for us to say, thus saith the Lord. But should that hinder us? Absolutely not. Jesus said, expect to be hated. That is the root of the opposition. Look what he tells his disciples in John chapter 15. He says, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would not love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. We should not be surprised by this, that MSNBC does not herald Christianity as the greatest thing on the face of the earth. We should realize ridicule and attacks on our reputation are going to happen. In verse 25, Jesus says, if they've called the master of the house Beelzebub, the chief of demons, which they called Jesus, should we be surprised if they say something negative about us? Think about that for just a moment. Because Satan really has never changed his tactics. Here's Jesus. Who is Jesus? He's the Son of God. But yet they were calling him the Prince of Demons. The exact opposite of who he was. When you and I proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, the fact that Jesus died and said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, that no man comes to the Father but by me, and that he died for each and every one of us, that we might have a relationship with our Creator in heaven. If we simply confess our sins, receive the forgiveness by faith, and walk in relationship with him, we're called haters. What could be more counter than that? I mean, that is sharing the love of God, but yet we're told that that is hate. And notice, he says that there will be resistance. He says, I'm sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. He doesn't say, well, I'm sending you out as a skunk. You know, how many people run from sheep? How many run from skunks? He doesn't say, I'm sending you out as an armadillo. Look, he says, I'm sending you out as sheep among the wolves. How much more vulnerable but harmless can we be than sheep? Now, I don't know, do we have any sheep farmers in here? All right, now, we don't have any sheep. We live out in the country. Oh, we do. Okay, all right. All right, I want to see you afterwards. I'm going to make sure my story's right here. We don't have any sheep where I'm at. We have about 20 acres, and we have a little bit of a farm. We have chickens, or had chickens. Chickens and dogs don't get along. We had a little incident a while back on our place, and I was off traveling, and I come home, and my youngest, Samuel, Bud, he was... He was waiting for me and his older brother to relay a story of something that happened during the week. My youngest daughter is in charge of the chickens and left the coop door open, and one of the dogs had a feast. And so Samuel meets us at the driveway and takes David to the back and shows him this pile of feathers. And he says, this is where the chickens were murdered. He didn't cut the dog any slack. You know, we're told that we're to be as wise as serpents, meaning we are to avoid danger when possible and protect ourselves, but we're to avoid that danger. We are not the aggressors. He says, rather, we are as harmless as doves. In other words, even though we've been warned that there are those who will hate us and want to destroy our reputations and in some cases our very lives, we are not victims, nor should we walk around with a Jesus chip on our shoulder waiting for somebody to knock it off. We are to go forth as sheep, being harmless as doves, because we carry a message of hope and life and a message that brings peace in the midst of great turmoil, insecurity, and fear. We are to live our lives with no fear. The consequences of living in fear are this. One, the deliverance and the freedom that we are to take to others will be denied. When you and I shrink back and we hide our faith and we become Secret Service Christians, refusing to identify our Lord and Savior, and we're silent when the very truth is under attack, guess what? There will be those who do not hear the truth nor come to a relationship with Jesus Christ and therefore the freedom that comes. As Jesus said, the truth will make you free. Should we not be proclaiming that truth that will allow people to live in the security of that, free of the fear of this world? But if that's not reason enough, here is yet another one. When you and I shrink back and we give in to the consequences of fear, there is divine denial that Jesus knows us. He says, when you and I refuse to acknowledge him before men, he will deny us before the Father who is in heaven. A little over a year ago, the Family Research Council became involved in an international event for a Sudanese Christian mother, 27-year-old Maryam Ibrahim. Any of you ever heard of Maryam? Maryam was sentenced to prison in Khartoum, in one of the most notoriously dangerous prisons in that country. She was sentenced to die for her faith in Jesus Christ. That was it. And when she was sent to prison, her son went with her. At the time, Martin was 18 months old, and he was confined into this prison where the United Nations says that one child a day would die because of the conditions being so bad. She was 6 months pregnant at the time of her incarceration. During this process, we became aware of her situation. We began to advocate with Congress, and we had several members of Congress in the House and the Senate working with us to plead for her release. And what really captured my attention was, here is this mother, and her husband, Daniel, was, by the way, an American citizen, and yet the Obama administration did very little to help them, even though he was an American and by birth the children American. He was in a wheelchair. She was the main caregiver. And under Sharia law, when she was executed, and by the way, she was going to be given 100 lashes for adultery because they didn't recognize the marriage, and then she would be executed. They were going to be very kind, though. They were going to let her give birth before they killed her. But here's the problem. In that country under Sharia law, the children would not be given to the father. They would be given to who nobody really knew where they would go. And so here's this mother, 6 months pregnant, an 18-month-old toddler at her side. And I understand the instinct of a mother to protect her children. And I can just think what was going through Maryam's mind as they came to her and they told her, Maryam, there's the door to the prison. You can be free if you'll simply renounce your faith in Jesus Christ. Now, can you think about it? I mean, who would have taken issue if this mother would have rationalized and said, well, look, I'm just going to say it, but really my fingers are crossed behind my back and I don't mean it. Because after all, look, little Martin here could grow up to be a great evangelist and reach the world for Christ. But if I'm taken away and I lose my life, who's going to care for him or my daughter? But she didn't do that. Not once, not twice, but three times, Maryam refused to renounce Jesus Christ as her Savior. And I'm happy to say she took that stand. And Christians around the world stood with her. And today, Maryam, her husband, and two children are living in freedom here in the United States of America. But there are still many, many men and women, moms and dads and children, Christians around this world who are being persecuted for nothing more than simply being followers of Jesus Christ. In fact, just 2 weeks ago, the European Parliament declared what is happening in the Middle East for what it is. It is genocide, and our government has refused to acknowledge that these believers are being targeted for extinction simply because they are followers of Jesus Christ. Friends, you and I here in America today are not being called to die for Jesus. We're simply being called to live for him. But we've allowed fear of man, fear of circumstances, to keep us from living the life that God has called us to live. I close with this. Jesus said, and if we're going to be his followers, we have to take up our cross and follow him. Now, there was no other reason to take up a cross. In Jesus' day, they didn't have necklaces with crosses on them. A cross was a certain form of execution. If you were to take up your cross, that means you were going to die. And Jesus is saying, if you want to follow me, take up your cross. Die to yourself. Die to your expectations. Die to your wants. Now, I am not by any means a movie buff, but I have about four or five movies that I like to watch. In fact, I've watched them so many times that I can basically give you line by line the movie. You know, one of the movies, my kids go crazy about this, but one of the movies we watch every Christmas, we watch It's a Wonderful Life. I mean, have you seen that movie? It's a great movie. It's one of my favorite. Another one that I like to watch is 12 O'Clock High. Have you all seen that movie? All right, I know in this age of surround sound and high def, it's not probably on the top of your list. Black and white movie starring Gregory Peck as General Frank Savage. And in this movie, it was released in 1949, and it depicts the Army's 8th Air Corps that flew these daylight precision bombing raids over Nazi Germany in World War II, a very strategic key turning point in World War II. In fact, my uncle, who passed away a few years ago here in Florida, was a bombardier on the B-17s. And the high number of the B-17s that were shot down and the crew members that were killed and missing in action was having a physiological effect upon the remaining members as they feared they would be next. And this fear of death, combined with the pronounced lack of discipline within the squadron, had put morale into a tailspin. And the fictional commander in the movie, Colonel Keith Davenport, was relieved of duty. And Brigadier General Frank Savage was brought in and placed in command. And upon assuming command, Savage assembles the men and he brings them all into a room similar to this. He stands up on the stage and this is what he says. He says, "We have got to fight, and some of us have got to die. I'm not going to try to tell you not to be afraid. Fear is normal. But stop worrying about it and about yourselves. Stop making plans. Forget about going home. Consider yourselves already dead. Once you accept that idea, it won't be so tough." And with that, he walks off the platform and out of the room. Now, that sounds pretty harsh. These young 17, 18-year-old, 20-year-old men who were facing death. But isn't that essentially what Jesus told his disciples? "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." As I said, there is no reason to take up a cross, an instrument of execution, unless it is for the purpose of dying. Jesus is saying, if you want to follow me, stop worrying about yourselves. Stop making plans. Quit worrying about your reputation. Consider yourselves already dead. And once we come to that point that our lives, our reputations, our plans really do not matter, then we are ready to follow Jesus Christ and to reach those who are dying with the words of life. Friends, live with no fear. Rather, choose to live in the faith that is eternal, that comes through a relationship with Jesus Christ. Let me pray for you this morning. Father, we thank you for your word and for your warning that there were going to be challenging times. Now, I know that in this nation for 240 years, most of the time, Christianity has been the default position, at least the worldview, and we've welcomed the church and its influence. But yet, Lord, we see now times very similar to the early church. These are challenging times. But should we be fearful? Absolutely not. But the only way we overcome that fear is first by having a relationship with you through your Son, Jesus Christ, which secures our eternity. And then, Father, by choosing to have a greater reverence for you than a fear of man. Father, I pray this morning for the Holy Spirit to give us that boldness that even the disciples in Acts chapter 4 and 5, when they were warned not to speak in the name of Jesus, they prayed not for a way out. They prayed for boldness to speak your word with even greater conviction. May that be our prayer this morning. With every head bowed, every eye closed here this morning, I just want to, no one looking around, I want to pray for you this morning. I want to leave you with a prayer of blessing. And I want to ask you, if you're here and you would say, you know what, I want that boldness. I want to live with no fear in living for Jesus Christ in the community, in the place, in school, in work, wherever God has placed you. If you would say, I want to overcome that fear and live with boldness, I want to pray for you this morning. Just slip up your hand. You want that boldness. Don't be intimidated. Father, I thank you for those hands that are across this auditorium this morning. And I pray, Father, for that boldness that comes through knowing you, walking with you, and being filled with your Holy Spirit. Just as Peter, who denied you three times, but then when something gripped his life, the boldness of the Holy Spirit, he challenged the entire nation. Give us that boldness to love in the face of hate. Give us the boldness to stand for truth in the place of deception. Lord God, give us that boldness. And I pray for those who have said this morning, give me that boldness to overcome fear. Continuing in prayer, you can place your hands down. You're here this morning and you are gripped with fear. And the reason would be because you don't know where you're going for eternity. And until you've secured your eternity, you can't live in the present. And if you've never invited Jesus Christ into your heart to be your Lord and Savior, I would plead with you this morning to make that decision. To invite Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior and to forgive you of your sins, and so that fear of the future is gone. Because the one who made you has redeemed you. If that's you this morning and you'd want me to pray for you, just slip up your hand right where you want Jesus Christ. Yes, I see. Yes, just hold those hands up. I want to pray for you. Yes, yes. Anyone else? Yes, I see that hand. Yes, I see that hand. Yes, I see that hand. Right where you are, yes, I see that hand. I want you to pray with me right where you are. God in heaven, I realize that I am a sinner and I need a Savior. And this morning I realize that Savior is Jesus Christ. And so by an act of my will, I ask you to forgive me. And I ask Jesus Christ to come into my heart and to be my Savior. And I declare that from this day forward, March the 3rd, 2016, that Jesus Christ will be the Lord of my life. And I will live with no fear. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen.
And let's stand and sing together. Thank you so much, Tony.
God bless America, land that I prairies, to the oceans wide with foam.
This is the 12th annual Vero Beach Prayer Breakfast, and what a blessing it's been. Before we go and rush out to get in our cars, we're going to pray, and we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer together very simply. Lord, thank you for teaching us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. God bless you. Go here and impact our community for Christ. God bless.
Days of